The need of permanent magnet DC motor, the advantage of PM DC motor over conventional DC motor, okay. And I think we have discussed construction of stator. So some of the part of stator we have discussed in previous class. So that is construction. We have discussed stator construction. Then what are the permanent magnets which we use in this PM DC motor? We have discussed four different types of that permanent magnets and their properties. So we have seen these Alnico magnets, ceramic or ferrite magnets, after that SF2-070 magnets and NDFEB magnets, okay. We have seen their BH curves and the product of BH. So that means according to the product of BH, these are the characteristics of the particular magnets. Okay. So if you put this particular BH curve, then this NDFEB, that particular NDFEB has the maximum value of B into H. So you can see that particular value from this table also. So the value of BH max is higher for NDFEB magnets. So basically these NDFEB magnets are used for the permanent magnet DC motor construction, that is for stator construction. But only one drawback of these magnets is, these magnets are generally temperature sensitive. So whenever we have to use the PMDC motor up to say 100 degree Celsius, then and then we can use these particular magnets, okay. So for higher temperature values, we have to go for the another type of magnets, okay. So this Alnico 7, again I have discussed the different properties. So there are one grade number, so 5 to 7 or 5 to 7 9. So as this grade number increases, the quality of that particular magnetic material also increases, okay. So we have discussed this particular magnetic material properties in previous class. Now in this particular lecture we are going to discuss, okay. So we have discussed these different types of stator frame constructions or stator frame structures for PMDC. So in these two stator frames, we generally use four different magnetic materials or four magnets, either at four longitudinal places, or that may be on four corner places of the stator frame, okay. And in these bottom three figures we have used total two magnets, two bar magnets. So there are different types of the stator construction and placements of bar magnets in this stator. Now let's move towards next, that is the armature structure for this particular PMDC motor. Now if you look towards armature, armature is basically the component of DC machine where the EMF get induced. Okay, so inside the armature there is an induction of EMF. So when we talk about conventional DC motors, then in conventional DC motors also the EMF is induced inside the armature, and whenever we connect that DC machine, when say in generating mode, whenever we connect that DC generator across load, then the whatever EMF which is induced inside the generator armature winding, that EMF is the cause behind the supplying current through that external load. So whenever we connect external load, then there will be flow of current through that load, and that current is generally forced by the EMF which is generated inside the armature winding. Okay. Whenever we talk about the DC motor, conventional DC motor, then also there is a EMF induced inside the armature winding which is known as the back EMF. That back EMF is always in opposite direction to that of supply voltage. And whatever back EMF which is induced inside armature during motoring mode, that EMF is the main cause behind generation of armature torque. So whatever armature torque which is generated inside the rotor, that torque is generally developed due to the back EMF which is induced inside the motor. Okay. So in generating mode as well as in motoring mode, whatever EMF which is required for the operation of that machine, so that EMF is basically generated inside the armature structure of the conventional DC motor. Similarly, when we talk about PMDC motor, the armature of PMDC motor is somehow similar to that of the conventional DC motor. Okay. So armature structure is same. So on rotor there is the armature core, then the armature winding is placed in the rotor slot, and after that there is commutator and brush arrangement. Okay, so number of commutator segments are there. So that commutator segments are connected to armature coils. So how many number of commutator segments are there? Kitne copper segments rehte hai commutator ke upar? Basically number of commutator segments on commutator is always equal to the total number of armature coils which are present on armature. So if armature consists n number of armature coils, then there will be n number of commutator segments. So same type of rotor structure is there in case of PMDC motor also. Okay, so only we replace field system by the permanent magnets. The rotating system, that is nothing but the armature system, is same as a PMDC motor, conventional DC motor. So here also, in case of a permanent magnet DC motors, armature is the part where EMF is induced, and whenever we connect that armature across the external load, then there will be flow of current through that external load if that motor acts as a generating or in generating mode, or that particular EMF is the main cause behind generation of torque whenever PMDC machine acts as a motor or as a PMDC motor. Okay. Now basically there are three types of armature structure in case of PMDC machine. So before moving towards these armature structures, let's initially recall the armature structure of a conventional DC machine. So if you recall armature structure of conventional DC machine, then that armature structure consists the laminated armature. So there is a central shaft, over that central shaft there is a laminated armature. That means the number of armature stacks or entire armature structure is made up of a small laminations or thin laminations. So such large number of laminations are stacked together, and that particular laminations are basically used, or that entire laminated structure is used as a armature. Again, on rotor periphery or armature periphery, there are number of grooves, or that grooves are generally termed as a slots. So number of armature slots are present on its entire outer periphery, and we generally laid armature conductors through that slots. Now that armature conductors are generally connected in series and parallel depending upon the type of armature winding. That may be lap winding, that may be wave winding. So this is your conventional DC motor armature. Okay, so number of armature coils are there, and that armature coils are generally placed inside the slots, and that slots are there on armature outer periphery. So I think you are familiar with the requirement of such laminated armature structure. So when if we use solid armature structure, then there will be formation of eddy current inside that solid armature structure, and that eddy current leads in eddy current loss, and that eddy current loss is generally considered as a core loss in a DC machine. Okay, so if we have to reduce this eddy current loss, then simply we have to reduce the eddy current which is flowing through that armature structure, and the only way to reduce that eddy current is to create an opposition to formation of that eddy current. That means we have to increase resistance of that entire armature. And how we increase resistance? If we decrease the thickness of armature, that means resistance is basically inverse, or resistance is inversely proportional to area of cross section, rho L divided by A. Resistance is inversely proportional to cross sectional area. So if we reduce cross sectional area of that armature, then effectively there will be increment in resistance, and that will leads in decrease in value of eddy current. So entire armature structure is made up of thin laminations. Every lamination is insulated from its adjacent lamination. So in between two laminations, adjacent lamination, there is a thin layer of varnish, and that varnish acts as an insulating material. So in this way, we generally make armature of a conventional DC machine as a laminated structure with a number of slots on its outer periphery. In case of PMDC machine, there are three different possible armature connections. That three armature possible connections are, first one is the armature structure is available either in slotted armature structure, So this slotted armature structure generally consists the number of slots on its rotor periphery or armature periphery similar to conventional DC motor. Second structure is the slotless DC armature structure. So there is no any slot present on armature rotor armature periphery. And third one is the moving coil structure. So this basically moving coil structure. This moving coil structure is generally available in a small PMDC motors which are present in toys. So whatever toys are there, so that or whatever toys which are generally running on remote. So that particular toys consist one small DC motor, and that particular DC motor is generally third type of armature structure, that is with moving coil. So if you open that particular DC motor, there is no any armature. Directly two coils or one or two coils or maybe sometimes two or four coils are there, and that coils are generally placed on one above another, and there is a formation of entire armature structure. So that is the basically your moving coil armature. So let's we discuss these three armature structures in detail. So first one is the slotted armature structure. Okay. So this is the slotted armature structure. So this slotted armature structure is similar to that of the conventional armature structure of conventional DC motor. Okay. So there are number of thin laminations, that all laminations are stacked together to form entire armature, and on outer rotor periphery there are number of slots. Okay. So now how many slots are there? Basically the slots are number of slots depends upon the size of that motor and requirement of torque from that motor. So for according to torque requirement and according to the size requirement, we can design the number of slots on outer periphery. So usually a core with a larger number of slots are reduced, and if we use core with large number of slots, then there will be reduction in the torque ripple. Now what is this torque ripple? So this torque ripple is nothing but the ripple or effect in the torque developed by that motor due to the cogging torque. Now I think you are familiar with the concept of cogging. In induction machine you have learned that concept of cogging, and if you have to induction motors are generally subjected to the cogging, and if you have to reduce that particular cogging, then we generally skew the rotor armature structure. So there is a skewing in armature structures or armature takes place, or we generally skew that rotor so that we can decrease this cogging torque. So in PMDC motors, basically to reduce these torque ripples which are developed by this cogging torque or that can be reduced by increasing number of slots. Okay. Sometimes the cogging can be also reduced by skewing. Okay. So we can skew that entire rotor structure, and by skewing we can decrease the cogging which is generated inside the PMDC motor. That means basically we have to reduce the cogging torque. Okay, and we can reduce that cogging torque by skewing the rotor. Now how this skewing eliminates cogging torque? The skewing eliminates the interaction between the rotor teeth and pole shoe. So whatever stator pole shoes are there and rotor teeth are there, so if simply we have to eliminate the interaction between that stator and rotor pole shoe, stator poles and rotor teeth, and we can reduce that particular interaction by simply skewing that rotor. Okay. So if we skew that rotor, then definitely there will be reduction in the skewing torque, that means nothing but the torque ripples which are developed inside the PMDC motor. So again, in large or for large size PMDC motors, rotors are generally skewed, and that rotor skewing is generally used to reduce the torque ripples or to reduce the effect of cogging torque. Now the slots and teeth dimensions, whatever slots which are present, so these are actually slots. Okay, whatever this structure is there, this is actually known as a slot, and this is teeth. Okay, so ye jo hai wo teeth hai. So these slots and teeth dimensions basically depends upon type of permanent magnet which is used on stator. Okay, so basically depending upon the type of permanent magnet, we can design the slots and teeth dimensions, whereas the number of slots is depends upon the torque requirement from that motor. Okay. Now machine with a ferrite magnets has the armature with a thin teeth and wider slots. So if we use a ferrite magnets, okay, that is nothing but the ceramic magnets. So if we use ceramic or ferrite magnet for the stator structure, then these armature slots are generally thin. Armature has a thin teeth and a wider slots. So slots are wider, teeth are thin.
Okay.
The use of thin teeth basically increases the flux density in the armature. So if we decrease the thickness of that teeth, then basically flux density which is developed inside the armature, that flux density get increases, and if we increase this particular teeth, the flux density will decreases. So there is an inverse relation between the flux density in air gap and the dimensions of teeth. Okay, so dimensions of teeth is flux density is inversely proportional to teeth dimension. So as this thickness of teeth is reduced, more space is now available for the housing of conductor. So if you simply understand that concept from this particular cross sectional view. So if we reduce this thickness of teeth, if thickness of this teeth reduces, then definitely there will be large slots. And if slots are wider, there is a large amount of space is there for placing armature winding or armature conductors. So in this particular slotted armature conductors, depending upon the torque requirement and the rating of machine or rating of PMDC motor, we can place or we can lay the different number of armature conductors. That armature conductors are connected in series parallel fashion. That again connection depends upon the requirement of ratings from that motor. Okay, and then this armature coils. Okay, why we connect that armature in series parallel fashion? To form a certain group of armature coils, and that armature coils terminals are now connected to the commutator segments. Okay, so this is the slotted armature structure. Next one is the slotless armature. Now, slotless armature name itself suggests there will be no any slot present on armature outer periphery. So in slotless armature structure, there is no slots present on armature periphery. So this is the another type of construction for rotor in which conductors are fixed on outer periphery of core. So it is core is simply made up of the stacking of a cylindrical laminations or simply circular laminations. So number of circular laminations are used, that all laminations are stacked together so that entire core is the cylindrical structure. So there is no any slot, no any teeth on outer periphery. So complete cylindrical structure is there, and whatever rotor conductors are there, that rotor conductors are nothing but the armature winding conductors. That armature winding conductors are fixed with the outer periphery of core. So on that outer periphery of the cylindrical core, we generally fix the armature conductors. Okay. So there is no any slot present on outer periphery. So the effective air gap length is larger in this particular armature as compared to the slotted armature. So if we use a slotless armature structure, then there will be large air gap in between stator and rotor, and hence we can Alnico and a rare earth permeance magnets can be used. So we can use Alnico magnets for the stator structure. Okay. An advantage of this particular construction is the reduction in the torque ripples. So basically torque ripples which are developed inside the armature, that torque ripples depends upon the slotting of armature structure. So as there is no any slots present on armature, definitely there will be no torque ripple observed in case of a slotless armature. So yadi armature ke upar slots hai, then and then only there will be formation of a ripple torque or cogging torque. Okay, if actually armature slots are absent, then definitely cogging torque which is developed inside armature is equal to zero. Okay. So this is the one of the important advantage of slotless rotor structure, that is we use this particular due to absence of slots, there will be reduction in the torque ripple. Now there is one important disadvantage for this particular motor. We cannot use this slotless PMDC motors for higher speed, because the strength of that entire armature is not so high as compared to the slotted armature structure. Because when we use a slotted armature, armature windings are generally placed inside the slot, and there is a complete insulation provided on that entire armature. So there is no any chances of outing of armature winding conductor from slots whenever we use that motor for high speed application. So definitely if motor speed or armature speed increases, whatever centrifugal forces which are subjected on the armature conductors, that centrifugal forces are also higher. So as slotted structure is there, definitely the armature winding is entirely stuck inside that slotted structure. So there is no any chances of outing of conductor from the slots. But when we use a slotless structure for high speed application, armature winding is simply placed over the cylindrical rotor structure or cylindrical armature structure. So there may be chances of conductor outing from the slot, or there may be chances of simply detaching that conductors from the rotor structure, and due to this we cannot use this slotless armature structure for high speed applications. Now third one is the moving coil armature. So in this particular structure, iron core is completely replaced by a non-magnetic core, and the basic function of that core is to only give a space for the moving coil. So there is no any requirement of iron core. Okay, so a small former like core is there, and only on that small former like core we place a moving coils. So armature winding is generally made up of a simple coils, and we place that coils on a non-magnetic core. Okay, so we generally use a glass fiber to construct that non-magnetic core. Okay, now basically this moving coil armature has advantages of low inertia and no iron losses, because iron losses only takes place inside the core of armature. Maximum iron losses takes place in the armature core. Okay, in case of a core of a stator, the iron losses are very negligible, whereas maximum core losses we subjected to the armature core, because when eddy current being generated whenever there is a flux cutting action between armature core and flux or magnetic field will takes place. So whenever that armature rotates, that armature along with armature conductors, armature core also cuts magnetic field, and according to Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, the EMF which is induced inside that core of armature, and as armature core is a short circuited structure, the induced EMF inside armature core will subjected to eddy currents. Again, when hysteresis loss will takes place, hysteresis losses will takes place inside the armature core whenever there is a magnetic reversal of core material takes place. Hysteresis losses are nothing but the power losses which takes place during reversal of magnetism. So kaun se condition mein magnetism ka reversal hoga? Whenever armature is subjected to the rotation. So whenever the armature is subjected to the rotation, each and every portion of that armature is subjected to reversal of magnetism. I think we have seen that particular concept. Okay, so whenever the entire armature structure is there, so if this is the A and B pole, so after 180 degree, what will be the pole placement? This is the B and A. Okay, B and A. And if we consider, suppose this is N pole and S pole, the magnetic lines of forces are from N to S. So whenever there is a 180 degree reverse or 180 degree rotation takes place, there will be this particular AB portion of a core gets subjected to the reversal of magnetism. And for this reversal of magnetism, definitely certain amount of power is required, and this power is generally termed as a hysteresis losses. Okay, so basically this armature or entire core losses are subjected inside the armature, because for generation of that core losses we require certain rotation of magnetic material. Okay, and this rotation is subjected by the armature only. But in case of moving coil armature, as armature is made up of a non-magnetic material, therefore there will be no any iron loss takes place inside the core of armature. So iron losses taking place inside the armature core is equal to zero. So that is one of the advantage of this moving coil armature. Now commutator and brushes. So this commutator brush arrangement is similar to that of the conventional DC motor. So commutator is made up of number of copper segments. The total number of copper segments are placed over the outer periphery of that commutator. Adjacent commutator segments are separated with or isolated from each other with thin layer of insulating material. Usually that insulating medium is the mica. So in between two adjacent layer there is a mica, so that mica acts as the insulating medium. The total number of commutator segments is always equal to total number of armature coils. So if armature consists 10 number of coils, then there will be 10 commutator segments are there on commutator structure. On that commutator structure we generally place a pair of brushes. That pair of brushes acts as a through that pair of brushes, either we can supply a current to armature winding, or we can extract current from armature winding in motor and generating mode respectively. So in motoring mode, we supply armature winding with the help of external current or external power supply. through brushes. In case of generating mode, we extract the EMF which is generated inside that armature through that brushes. Okay, so there is a commutator and brush arrangement. So this commutator brush arrangement is generally similar to that of conventional DC mode. Okay. Now, this is actually the commutator and brush arrangement. So the total number of armature windings are there. The number of armature windings are connected to this armature winding is nothing but the armature coil. So this is one armature coil. Okay. So one end of that armature coil is connected to one commutator segment. Its next end is connected to adjacent commutator segments. Okay. So say suppose this is coil number one. Say this is coil number one. This is coil number two. Then one end of coil number 1 is connected to say segment number 1, second end of coil number 1 is connected to coil segment number 2. For second coil, first end is connected to segment 2, and second end of that second coil is connected to segment 3. In this way, there will be connection of armature coil or armature winding. So one armature coil, if we consider two armature coils, that has total 4 leads. 2 leads for each armature coils. If how we connect that 4 leads to commutator segment, so say this is armature coil 1, armature coil 2, one lead of first armature coil is connected to say segment 1, second lead is connected to segment 2, for one first lead of second commutator coil is connected to segment 2, second lead is connected to segment 3, then after next armature coil. That means when we consider suppose third armature coil, first lead of third armature coil is connected to segment 3 and second lead is connected to segment 4 and so on. So for last coil, say 10th coil. 10th coil means there will be 10th commutator segments. So for 10th coil, first lead of 10th coil is connected to commutator segment number 10 and second lead of that 10th coil is connected to commutator segment number 1. So in this way, that entire circular structure and connection of armature coil and commutator is there. So this figure actually gives the overview of how we connect armature windings and commutator. So we have to excite this armature winding with the help of external supply. So for this purpose, we use a brush arrangement. So through that brushes, the energy or power is supplied to this armature winding. Now next one is the working principle of this particular PMDC motor. So working principle of PMDC motor is same as that of the conventional DC motor. So conventional DC motor basically works on principle that whenever the current carrying conductor is placed in magnetic field, it experiences the force, and the magnitude of that force experienced by conductor is given by B into I into L, where B is the magnet value of flux density or air gap flux density, I is the current which is flowing through the armature coil or conductor, and L will be the length of conductor, okay, or length of armature coil. So I is the current through conductor, L is the length of conductor. So on same working principle, the PMDC motor will work. So if you have to simply run that PMDC motor, we connect armature winding of that PMDC motor to external DC supply. So as armature winding is connected to external DC supply, the armature winding carries current. Okay, depending upon the resistance of armature, entire armature structure and resistance of brushes, that armature winding will carry current, and that armature winding acts as a current carrying winding or current carrying conductor. Whatever magnetic field which is required for the operation of PMDC motor, that magnetic field is generally produced or developed by the permanent magnets which are there on stator. So on stator there are the permanent magnets, and that permanent magnets generates the required amount of magnetic field. So there is a magnetic field generated by permanent magnets which are there on stator. Next one is, there is a current carrying conductor which is nothing but the current carrying armature winding, and whenever we place that current carrying armature winding inside the magnetic field, there will be each and every conductor will experiences the force, and due to the resultant force experienced by that entire winding, the motor will run, rotates, or that entire armature structure will rotate. If we have to reverse the direction of rotation for the PMDC motor, then we can use same logic as that of the DC motor. How we reverse the direction of rotation for DC motor? In case of conventional DC motor, either by changing connections of field winding or armature winding, we can reverse the direction of rotation. So if say motor rotates in clockwise direction, if you have to reverse the direction of rotation for that motor, either interchange the polarity of armature winding or field winding. If we simultaneously interchange polarity of armature and field winding, the motor will rotates in same direction. ओके सो दोनों में से किसी भी एक वाइंडिंग में से फ्लो होने वाले करंट का डायरेक्शन आपको रिवर्स करना है. इफ वी रिवर्स पोलैरिटी दैट मींस वी सिंपली चेंज द करंट व्हिच इज फ्लोइंग थ्रू और डायरेक्शन ऑफ करंट व्हिच इज फ्लोइंग थ्रू दैट वाइंडिंग. सो इफ द डायरेक्शन ऑफ करंट फ्लोइंग थ्रू वाइंडिंग गेट चेंजेस देयर विल बी चेंज इन द डायरेक्शन ऑफ रोटेशन. सेम लॉजिक इज एप्लीकेबल फॉर पीएमडीसी मोटर. बट इन केस ऑफ पीएमडीसी मोटर वी कैनॉट चेंज द डायरेक्शन ऑफ मैग्नेटिक फील्ड बिकॉज मैग्नेटिक फील्ड इज डेवलप्ड बाय permanent magnets itself. In case of conventional DC motor, we can change the direction of magnetic field by changing the polarity of field supply. Okay, so if we change the polarity of field connection, there will be the reverse direction current flows through field winding that will change the pole formation on stator pole. But such case is not there in case of PMDC motor because PMDC motor consists permanent magnets. So as permanent magnets are there, we cannot change the field pole polarity. So only one way is there, simply reverse the polarity of armature winding. Okay, so simply interchange the polarity of armature winding, say this is say plus and minus, and for such case if motor rotates in clockwise direction, if you have to reverse this particular direction of rotation, simply interchange the polarity. So make this negative, make this positive, motor will definitely rotate in counterclockwise direction. Okay, so by changing polarity of armature terminal, we can rotate this particular machine in opposite direction. So whenever armature winding carries current, there will be generation of a back EMF inside that armature winding. Okay, and this back EMF generally produce the required amount of torque in armature. Okay, so the back EMF is generally opposite to that of the applied voltage, and this applied voltage has to force the current through armature winding against that back EMF. Okay, ideally the magnitude of back EMF is equal to that of the terminal voltage. Both terminal voltage and back EMFs are nearly equal to each other. Okay, so this back EMF against this back EMF, the applied voltage, that is nothing but the terminal voltage, has to supply the current through armature, and this electrical energy which is required, that electrical energy for overcoming the opposition is getting converted into mechanical energy. So this principle is similar to that of the conventional DC motor. Now again, torque equation is also similar to that of the conventional DC motor. Torque equation of PMDC motor is also similar to conventional DC motor. So we have derived this torque equation. So let's overview on this torque equation. So there is only one change in the torque equation. We will discuss what change is there. So to derive this torque equation and equivalent circuit of PMDC motor, let's consider certain parameters. So I will be the current flowing through armature conductor. IA is the total current external in external armature circuit. I is current through each armature conductor, and IA is the actual armature current. I think all of you are familiar with the armature current and current in each conductor. Okay, armature is made up of number of parallel paths. Okay, so armature is generally made up of number of parallel paths. So say one parallel path, second parallel path, third parallel path, and say fourth parallel path. And these paths are connected in parallel to each other. And this will be the total current, which is nothing but your armature current IA. Now what is this I? I is the current through each armature conductor. That means this is the current which is flowing through every armature conductor. Every armature winding is identical, so all these armature windings are identical. So as armature windings are identical, each winding will carry same amount of current. Okay, armature winding identical hai means uska matlab kya hai? The number of turns which are present on that armature winding is same. Again, all armature windings are wounded with a same gauge copper wire. Okay, so copper wire ka gauge means actually size of wire or diameter of wire. So we generally use a term gauge in electrical terminologies to measure the diameter of wire. Okay, so windings are basically made up of a same gauge. Winding consists equal number of turns, therefore the length of winding as well as cross-sectional area of that winding is same. All four windings is same, and definitely due to that the total resistance of or sorry resistance of each winding is same. If resistance is same, we know that if equal resistance are connected in parallel, all that resistances will carry equal magnitude of current. Okay, this is the basics of electrical engineering. Okay, so as windings are identical, so all that winding will carry equal number of current. So for this case, the number of parallel paths is equal to 4. Okay, total armature current is Ia. So what will be the current flowing through each armature conductor? That will be equal to Ia divided by 4. Ia divided by 4. Or in general, we can say I is equal to total armature current Ia divided by total number of parallel paths. Total number of parallel paths, and we generally represent that number of parallel path by letter capital A. So Ia is equal to, sorry, I is equal to Ia divided by capital A. B is the air gap flux density. Okay, that is the flux density in air gap. Phi is the flux per pole. That is flux generated by stator poles in per pole basis. Omega is the angular velocity. Angular velocity in radians per second. Okay, so angular velocity, n is what? It is the velocity in, yes, what is unit of velocity n? Meter per second. It is meter per second. So when we convert, it is angular, that is nothing but simple 2 pi into n. 2 pi n is the angular velocity. Okay, so angular frequency and frequency. F is the frequency in hertz. Angular frequency generally denoted by omega. Omega is the angular frequency which is we calculate by 2 pi into f in radians. Okay, so omega is the angular velocity in radians per second. A is the total number of parallel paths. So here this term is nothing but the total number of parallel paths in armature structure. P will be the total number of stator poles. P is the number of poles. R is the radius of armature conductor, or it is actually radius of armature because we have to determine torque. Torque is generally calculated by taking product of force into radius. So R is the radius of armature structure. Okay, so whatever armature cylinder is there, or that cylindrical armature structure is there, radius of that cylindrical armature is R. Z will be the total number of armature conductors, and N is the effective length of armature conductor. Now again, if you recall construction of armature, we generally we consider only the armature conductors which is present inside the slot. The dead conductors are generally outside conductors, which are actually connections. Connections are generally considered as a dead conductor. So if I consider, suppose this is the cylindrical armature, so whatever conductors which are present inside these slots, that conductors are only considered for the analysis purpose. Its connection, outer connections, these connections are generally termed as a dead connections. Okay, because this side conductor generally does not take active part in flux variation, and therefore this conductor is generally considered as a dead conductor. Okay, so whatever Z is there, Z is the total number of conductors which are there inside armature, and length is there, this is the length of armature conductor. Okay, so whatever L term consider is there, this L term is the effective length of armature conductor in meter. In simple, this is the effective length of entire armature structure. Armature cylinder jo hai, us cylindrical armature ka jo length rahega, that length itself is the length of armature conductor. F will be the force experienced by conductor. T is the torque developed in Newton meter, and Eb is the back EMF. So for deriving torque equation, let's consider only one conductor. So the torque experience on a single armature conductor is equal to B into I into L. Force experience on each conductor. So whenever current carrying conductor is placed in magnetic field, it will experience a force. The magnitude of that force is equal to B into I into L. So torque due to one conductor. So how we calculate torque? So this is suppose the armature structure. Let us consider this is circular. Okay, this is one conductor which is considered. So whatever force which is developed on this conductor, always that force is in tangential direction to that of armature structure. So this is the force. So this force multiplied by radius of armature is nothing but the torque. Okay, so force into radius is the torque. So torque is or torque due to one conductor is equal to force, which is Bi into L into radius. Okay. Now what is circumferential area? circumferential area of this entire armature structure is equal to 2 pi L into R. Circumferential area 2 pi L. 2 pi L is what? Yes, what is 2 pi L in case of cylinder? Yes, online members, what is 2 pi L in case of cylinder? Yes. Pi L in case of cylinder. Okay, think on that. I'm not going to give you answer for this. Okay, next lecture, please give me that answer. Okay. So the circumferential area is equal to 2 pi L into R. So 2 pi L into R is the circumferential area for the armature, entire armature structure. So P phi is equal to V into 2 pi L R. Therefore, P L R from this equation, P L R is equal to P phi divided by 2 pi. Okay. Now, what is I A? I A is equal to A into I. Here we have to find I is equal to I A by A. So, I A is equal to A into I. Therefore, if we substitute I A is equal to A into I in this, then this torque due to one conductor is equal to P phi into I A divided by 2 pi into A. We have discussed this particular derivation in torque equation of DC machine. Okay, so P phi into I A divided by 2 pi into A. So torque T is equal to P phi divided by 2 pi A into I A into Z. This is what? This is torque due to one conductor. Ye kya hai? Is torque developed by one conductor. Armature consists total z number of conductor. So total torque is equal to torque by one conductor multiplied by number of conductor. So P phi divided by 2 pi A into I A, it is torque by one conductor multiplied by number of conductors, that is multiplied by z. Therefore T is equal to P z into phi divided by 2 pi A into I A. Now all these terms are constant. P is constant, Z is constant, phi is also constant in case of PMDC motor. Number of parallel path for armature is also constant. Therefore, torque T is equal to KT into IA, where KT is constant. Now, if you recall torque equation for a conventional DC motor, then that torque equation T is equal to some constant K multiplied by armature current IA into flux phi. For conventional DC motor, torque equation is equal to K into IA by phi. Therefore, we say torque is proportional to armature current into flux phi. So, whenever we consider a DC shunt machine, then for DC shunt machine, flux phi is constant. Therefore, torque is proportional to armature current. For DC series machine, flux phi is proportional to armature current because armature and field windings are connected in series. So for series machine, armature current and field current, both currents are same. So for series machine, IA or phi is proportional to IA. Therefore, torque is proportional to square of armature current. Therefore, series motor generally gives high value of starting torque. So there is a one justification why series machine gives high starting torque. Okay, so the reason is flux phi is proportional to armature current. Therefore, torque is proportional to square of armature current. But in case of PMDC motor, flux phi is constant. We can vary this flux phi in case of conventional DC machine, because if you have to vary flux phi, we have to vary current flowing through field winding. Flux is always proportional to field current. So if we increase field current, flux increases. If we decrease field current, flux decreases. Again, there is a one condition. That condition is up to point of saturation. Up to point of saturation, flux and currents are linear. After point of saturation, that means whenever field circuit gets saturated, the value of flux remains constant. Flux remains constant. Okay. Therefore, that is for conventional DC machine. But in case of PMDC machine, field system is made up of the permanent magnets. So whatever field which is developed by that permanent magnet, that is flux per pole is always constant. So phi is always constant for PMDC machine. Therefore, we consider that phi in a KT. So, the torque equation for PMDC motor is T is equal to KT multiplied by IA. So, torque is only proportional to current flowing through armature winding. If you have to increase armature torque, simply we have to increase current flowing through armature winding. Okay. So by controlling this armature current, we can control the torque developed by armature winding. Now the equivalent circuit of PMDC motor is same as that of the conventional DC motor. Okay. So only in conventional DC motor, in equivalent circuit, we have to show the field system. That means when we say this is suppose shunt machine, conventional shunt motor, along with this armature structure there is a one field structure. Sorry. Along with this armature there is a field coil which is connected in parallel with armature for shunt machine. Whenever we consider series machine, then along with this armature there is one field coil which is connected in series with field machine. So that is in equivalent circuit of conventional DC machine. But in case of PMDC machine, field system is replaced or field winding is replaced by a permanent magnet. So this field winding, or as there is no any field winding, therefore that field winding system or field system is not present in equivalent circuit. Okay, so equivalent circuit only consists the armature along with armature resistance RA, and this is the armature coil. So EB is the back EMF which is developed inside armature coil. How we calculate that EB? EB, again same formula, P phi Zn divided by 60 times A. Only here N is changes in radians per second. EB ka formula, regular formula kya hai? P phi Zn upon 60 A, where N is the speed of armature in Newton per meter. Okay, or in RPM, basically in RPM, sorry, not in Newton per meter, because Newton per meter is the torque. Okay, or meter per second, RPM or meter per second. Okay. So basically we consider that speed N in RPM or RPS, but here we generally consider that speed in radians per second. Okay, so we calculate that EB, and EB is generally proportional to this omega, or in simple EB is proportional to N, that is speed in RPM. Okay, so whenever armature is stationary, the back EMF developed inside that armature is equal to zero, therefore at the starting that armature will carry maximum current. So to limit that starting current, we generally use starters in conventional DC machine. Okay, so back EMF is always proportional to speed of a DC machine. Okay, so this is the equivalent circuit for a PMDC machine. So again we can write the terminal voltage equation similar to similar to concepts by which we have written voltage equations for a conventional DC machine. So here DC machine voltage equation, that is PMDC voltage equation, V is equal to back EMF EB plus drop across this armature winding. If we neglect brush voltage drop, if brush voltage drop is considered, then along with this particular EB and armature voltage drop, we have to consider brush voltage drop. Okay, so terminal voltage V is equal to RA into IA is nothing but the voltage drop inside the armature. This KT into omega itself is the back EMF. So back EMF developed inside armature plus IARA plus PVD. If we consider that brush voltage drop, and if we neglect that brush voltage drop, then V is equal to EB plus IA into R. Okay. So torque is equal to KT into R. So these are the two equations which generally gives the performance parameters of PMDC. Okay. This is the simple equivalent circuit. Okay.